All right. Well, welcome everybody to all of the early birds out there on the World Wide Web. Welcome to a new episode of the West Coast Jazz Hour in February. Today we are welcoming a very, very, very special guest. He is a saxophone player and musician who has played with an enormous amount of people. His discography is almost with credited with 1,000 records almost, played in all different kinds of genres, and the list of names that this gentleman has worked with is very long, but a little impression is he played with Buddy Rich and his big band, Charlie Hayden's Quartet West, the Gerald Wilson Orchestra, Doc Severinsen Big Bands, Bobby Hutcherson, Thelonious Monk, Ella Fitzgerald, Jerry Mulligan, George Duke, Nancy Wilson, Marvin Gaye, Carole King, The Four Tops, Steely Dan, Bill Withers, Aretha Franklin. I could go on and on and on about this gentleman. He is a master of the music, and me and my co-host Josh Nelson are very happy and honored to welcome Mr. Ernie Watts to the show today. Welcome, Ernie. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, Ernie, what we usually start with doing in our podcast is that we basically ask every guest, when did you move to Los Angeles and why did you move to Los Angeles? And basically start talking about, the people who you played out here, because you are originally from Norfolk, Virginia, if I have that correctly.
That's where I was born, but I grew up in Wilmington, Delaware.
Okay.
I started playing in Wilmington, so I just tell everybody I'm from Wilmington, Delaware.
Right.
Yeah.
So when did you make the transition to LA, and is there a specific person who brought you out here?
I moved to LA in 1968, and I moved here after working with Buddy Rich for like 2.5 years. I was at the Berklee School in Boston, and Buddy was working at in Boston, in the Boston area, a place called Lenny's on the Turnpike. And he had a great alto player with him, a guy named Gene Quill. Gene decided that he was going to go back to New York one night, and so Buddy's band manager, young trombone player named Jim Trimble, called Phil Wilson at the Berklee School. Phil Wilson had just started teaching at Berklee, and he asked Phil who he would recommend, a young player that he would recommend to play with Buddy for another week or so, until Buddy got to New York and they could get a real saxophone player, they could get an adult. So Phil recommended me, and so I left Berklee and I joined Buddy, and I was with Buddy for 2.5 years. I tell everybody, I guess they couldn't find a real saxophone player. So what happened was, we toured all over the world. I did three or four records with Buddy, and traveled everywhere. And we went to LA in 1960, maybe like the beginning of 1968. It was during that time in the summer. They used to have summer replacement shows for those big successful variety shows they used to have. We were set up to do a summer replacement show for the Jackie Gleason show, and it was called the Away We Go show, and it was Buddy's band. It was Buddy Greco was a singer, and the comedian was oh, I forget now.
Young guy with him.
I'll come back to
Carlin,
that.
George Carlin.
George Carlin.
Oh.
George Carlin was a comedian. So this was called the Away We Go. show. We were there. These summer replacement shows were 13 weeks. So I was there for 13 weeks in LA the summer of 1967, something like that. And they had the band augmented by a woodwind section. And so our friend Gene Cipriano,
mm-hmm.
Bill Green,
oh yeah,
Bob Cooper, ooh. And I forget who else was one of the other saxophone, one of the other reed players. And I met all these guys while I was doing this summer replacement show. And I started doing, you know, you didn't work every day. So I started playing in rehearsal bands and that kind of thing. I think I met Mike Barone then and different people that had had rehearsal bands at that time. So I really liked LA. I really liked the weather. I liked the way it felt. I liked the mountains, you know. Mm-hmm. I grew up in the East. I grew up in Wilmington, Delaware. I used to go to New York on the weekends to hear everybody at Birdland.
Uh-huh.
But I really liked LA. So when I left Buddy, I decided to move to LA because I figured I knew about as many people in LA as I knew in New York. And I felt better about moving to LA. So I moved to LA in 1968, and that's how I got there.
Wow, right on.
Yeah. So then it just evolved from there.
Yeah, and who were then some of the people when you actually moved out here, who were some of the people that you first started working with?
Well, I was very, very blessed.
Yeah.
1968, around then, was the same time that Motown was moving from Detroit to Los Angeles, and they used to record at the RCA studio on Sunset before they got their own studio. There was a contractor named Ben Barrett that started calling me to do dates for Motown when they moved. I originally started recording and working as a sub. You know, I would be a sub for Bill Green. I would be a sub for Jackie Kelso, Buddy Collette,
mm-hmm.
Cipriano, because I played oboe too, you know, at that time. So from being a sub, I started to get my own calls, you know. So when Motown moved from Detroit, I started working in horn sections for all of those Motown things, you know, the Temptations, the Commodores, Diana Ross, the Jacksons, all of those people, Willie Hutch, a lot of different people. And also I started working with Oliver Nelson, who moved out from New York. He put a band together. I worked with Oliver. We did a 3-month tour of Africa.
Wow.
With a State Department.
Oh, yeah. Tour.
And yeah. It was with the Blues and the Abstract Truth size mm-hmm. band, you know, so that was very nice. Freddie Hill played trumpet and John Klemmer played saxophone.
Oh, John Klemmer, yeah.
And so it was a very nice band. Stan Gilbert, Bob Morin. I don't know if you ever heard of Bob Morin. Great player. Was on drums.
Mm.
And it was a very nice thing. And we did that for 3 months. Then we came back to LA. And I was playing with Oliver. I was playing with Gerald Wilson's band.
Mm-hmm.
I started subbing on Mike Barone's band. And what happened was they used to have staff orchestras for everything. All the studios had a staff orchestra that worked a full 40-hour week, and they had backup people. You know, like 20th Century Fox had 800 people in their staff orchestra for films. Columbia, Warner Brothers, all of those big studios had staff orchestras. Well, NBC had a staff orchestra, And they had a saxophone player with their orchestra named Gabe Baltazar, great alto player, used to play with Stan Kenton.
Yep.
He was Hawaiian. He decided to move back to Hawaii because he was going to lead the Royal Hawaiian Concert Band. So there was a hole in the woodwind section at NBC, and I was asked to go on staff at NBC. So I was on staff at NBC for about the last 2 or 3 years that they had staff orchestra there. During that time, the Tonight Show would come from New York to California for 2 weeks at a time as like a hiatus thing that they would do. And so I started playing with the Tonight Show band when it was just coming out for 2 weeks at a time. I met Doc when I was with Buddy's band.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we played at this place in New York called the Riverboat. It was in the bottom of the Empire State Building. And I met Doc and I met Benny Goodman.
Mm-hmm.
And I met all those people down there, you know, coming to see Buddy's band. You know, they all loved Buddy because he was an incredible character. You know? And I met all of those people when I was with him. So I started doing the Tonight Show, and they then moved to Los Angeles. They moved to Los Angeles in 1971. And I started working as a regular in the Tonight Show band from then. It was from 1971 to 1991 that I was in the Tonight Show band.
Wow, that's a long time.
Until Carson retired. So at that time, also, I was doing record dates and films and other TV shows. And I had a great sub, Tom Peterson, that we would share.
Yeah.
You know, and it worked out great. You know, it's like if I had a film call that was all day and I couldn't make the show, I could call Tom and Tom would go in and he would help me out with that. And we did that for years, you know. So it sort of evolved that way. I played on all of the R&B things. I played on pop things. I did films. I did, you know, all of the records. So it was a very, very busy time, you know.
Yeah.
So that's how that got rolling. Everything is relationships. And when you play and people hear you play, then they want to hang out and play too, because it feels right, it feels good. And so things evolved from the music, you know. It really evolved from just enjoying being in other people's company, enjoying playing the music. I met Frank Zappa that way. I met so many people that way, just through the music.
Right. Yeah. That's an incredible, incredible story. And, you know, like the amount of people that you've played with is also incredible. You were right there in the middle of the musical heyday, I would say.
Yeah, so. I was very, very blessed. You know, it was like I walked in and the doors opened. Hey, we've been waiting for you. Come over here and play some here. Come over here and play some there. So it worked out great. You know, I mean, J.J. Johnson came to L.A. to do films. Oliver did films. Benny Golson did films. All of these people came off the road to work in L.A., and I did jingles for Benny Golson. I did films and stuff for Jay, you know, and Oliver, a lot of those things, you know, the $6 Million Man and all of those kind of shows.
Oliver, right.
Oliver did all of those things.
Yeah.
So I was, you know, I was there.
Yeah.
Don't ask me. They asked and I said yes.
Yeah. I would do too.
Yeah.
Well, that's really, really incredible to hear. Why don't we go to some music, Josh?
Yeah.
You have something lined up for us.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is a song from your Wheel of Time record from 2016, which I've been enjoying very much. And it is the Joe Henderson composition Inner Urge that we're going to hear. And this features your European band, correct?
Right.
Right. And that
personal singer Rudy Engel on bass and Heinrich Kerberling on drums.
Very Christoph good.
Plays piano, and these guys are all really great players. And
yeah. Sure.
We've worked together for like 20 years now.
Wow. That's beautiful. Yeah. Well, let's listen to the Ernie Watts Quartet Inner Urge from Wheel of Time 2016, and our special guest today, the great Ernie Watts. Thanks for watching, everybody. We'll be right back. Wow.
Yeah.
Killing.
Nice tune.
Well, you play it beautifully, and yeah, I agree, it is a nice tune. If you're just joining us, this is the great Ernie Watts, and that was his version of Joe Henderson's Inner Urge off the Wheel of Time record from 2016, and that's from your own label. Is that Flying Dolphin?
That's from Flying Dolphin. Patricia and I, my wife Patricia and I, we started Flying Dolphin in 2005.
Oh, okay.
So
Yeah,
that
2004.
2004.
Thanks, Patricia. And that's
So.
probably right around the time that or just after I got the beautiful opportunity to play with you and hang with you a little bit.
Right. That's right.
Yeah.
You played at our wedding.
Yeah. Oh, I'm honored to have played at your wedding, and I not only got to play at your wedding, but that was the day and the only time I got to meet Charlie Hayden.
Charlie was there, and
Yeah.
Michel Colombier was there. Great composer.
Yes, Michel
A lot
Colombier.
of beautiful musicians. Yeah, I was
Yeah.
working with Charlie at that time.
Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. So yeah, we and then I played in your quartet a few times, and with Mike Barone's big band.
That's right.
Really, really fun. So yeah, I assume Joe Henderson is one of your heroes, influences, if you will.
Yeah, he was. You
Yeah.
know, my main influence was John Coltrane, of course.
Yeah, I was gonna
You
ask.
know,
Yeah.
so
Okay.
yeah, when I was 13, I heard John Coltrane on Kind of Blue, and it sort of, you know, it kind of changed all my chromosomes, you know, because I was learning to play. I started playing when I was 13. And we didn't have a jazz program at our school, so I was learning classical saxophone repertoire. But my mother joined the Columbia Record Club, right? I started playing when I was 13. My folks, you know, the only music my folks knew about was on the radio. So we were listening to whatever was on the radio, and that was Little Richard and Bill Haley and the Comets and all of those, you know, the Coasters and the Drifters and all of that kind of 50s rock and roll music. And the only saxophone player you could really hear on the radio at that time, I think Bill Haley had a saxophone with him. The guy that had the hit was Earl Bostick, had a hit on Flamingo. And then King Curtis was a session player, and he played on all of those beginning rock and roll records with the Coasters and the Drifters and all of that stuff, Charlie Brown and all of those things where he played the saxophone fills and stuff. That was the only saxophone I heard. So my mom was very supportive. My father was very supportive, but they didn't know anything about music. So I was studying the saxophone as a kid in school, and they decided I was practicing every day on my own, under my own volition. So my mother figured out I wasn't going to quit. So for Christmas time, she bought me a little stereo record player from Sears Roebuck. I mean, at that time, Sears had this gigantic catalog. They had a music section, they had auto stuff, they had all kinds of things. So their music section for this big catalog was called Silvertone. And my mom bought me this Silvertone record player that was stereo, you know, because you set the record player here and you took the speaker off of the front of the record player and you put it over there and you have two speakers, so it was stereo. You know, and she joined the Columbia Record Club, and the Columbia Record Club would, you know, they had offers their monthly record and that kind of stuff. But the first record that you get from Columbia is the freebie. It's free. So my mother says, well, you know, he's playing an instrument. He's a saxophone player. He's playing an instrument. I'll get an album with an instrument on it. So she got this Miles Davis album called Kind of Blue. That was my first jazz record, and it was a new record then. So that was 1959. Mm-hmm. All of that stuff was going on then. So I heard everybody on the record. You know, I heard Wynton Kelly was on there, and Bill Evans was also on there. Paul Chambers, he played on every jazz record in the 50s. Right. He was an incredible bass player. He played on any record you got. Paul Chambers was on it.
Yeah.
You know, and then let's see who else we had. Well, Miles, of course, and Jimmy Cobb had just taken Philly Joe Jones' place with Miles. I think that was one of the first gigs that Cobb did. And so this tenor player was John Coltrane. And for my 13-year-old head, for my 13-year-old ears, what I was hearing was everybody in the band had a similar kind of vocabulary. They had a way they played that was similar to the other guys in the band. But when Coltrane played, it sounded like it was in another key, but it worked. You know, it was like he was playing with the other guys and it sounded great, but he didn't play like them. You know, it sounded like he was playing in another key. So from the time I was 13 or 14, all I really wanted to do was play in the other key.
Yeah.
No, I have to do that.
Yeah.
I have to do that. What is that? You know? So what I did as a kid was I took my lunch money and my allowance money every week, and I bought a John Coltrane record. Then I would take my Coltrane records and I put them on my little record player at night, right? And listen to all these Coltrane records as I fell asleep. So basically, you know, I didn't know any of this stuff, but I knew it, but I didn't know it. Basically what I was doing was I was programming my subconscious mind to hear intervallically and harmonically in a certain way.
Right.
That I didn't even know about. So when I played those things, you know, the minor third things, the fourth things, all of the things interval wise, and I didn't know what they were, but I knew that that's what I was hearing.
Right.
So I played by ear the whole time I went through high school. You know, I was studying saxophone. I studied classical saxophone. I played a very famous saxophone concerto with members of the Philadelphia Orchestra in Wilmington, Delaware, called the Jacques Ibert Concertino de Camera.
Oh, that's beautiful.
A very famous classical piece. I played that when I was like 16 or so, 16 or 17 with the orchestra. So I was studying, learning how to play the instrument correctly, learning how to play in tune and all of those things. And then what I did was after I graduated from high school, my mother was scared to death. I told my mom that I wanted to be a musician. And she, you know, after she got up off the floor, right, she, you know, because everybody, all of our families, all of our friends, all they know about musicians are those terrible, tragic hero stories that are in the movies and all of that about the guy that grows up and he does himself in some sort of way, and it's a horrible life, and you know, everybody dies in the gutter. Right. So anyway, my mom is going, well, you know, if you're going to do that, why don't you get a teacher's degree so that you'll have something to fall back on? You know, that's what your mom does because she doesn't want you to starve to death. You know, she's scared to death anyway because you said musician. So she's already in shock, right? So I say, okay, I'll try. And so when I graduated from high school, I went to the Westchester State Teachers College in Pennsylvania. That was near Philadelphia. And I was there for a year. it didn't work out for me. So I dropped out and I did some private teaching. And then I got a scholarship to the Berklee School. When I got the scholarship to the Berklee School in Boston, that's when I connected the science of music with the intuitive thing. Up until that point, I had been reading. You know, I was a good reader, so I could read all the tunes. I could read the Charlie Parker tunes and play those things, but I was improvising by ear. So every now and then I'd fall in a hole. You know, I'd hear something that I couldn't match up by ear. When I went to Berklee, I learned that there was a scale for every chord. So in my simple head, what I figured was, okay, there's a scale for every chord. So if I learn all the scales for all the chords, then it's impossible for me to make a mistake, and improvisation becomes an elaborate game of multiple choice. Right? As long as you're picking the notes that are in the scales, you're not going to play any wrong notes. Then you can organize them in your own order and create your own lines. I was always interested in playing, you know, in that other key again. So I wasn't involved in learning. A lot of people learn what you would call licks from other people's playing, other great players. They memorize all of these patterns that they play, and then they regurgitate those patterns in a certain order, and this order that they regurgitate them in creates their voice, creates their style. You know, so a lot of people's playing becomes a hodgepodge of other people's playing.
Right.
I listen to Coltrane continually, and there's so much stuff that he played that you couldn't really copy,
right?
You know, in that way. Mm-hmm. It was energy music. You know, I call it energy music. It was the beginning of what we call the avant-garde. But to me, it was always, and it still is, it's energy music. It's touching on to a certain aspect of universal energy. You know, it's universal energy that comes through to create these things. Bird had that. He had his hand on it, but he didn't take it all the way. A lot of people did, but they didn't take it all the way. Coltrane, to me, is the only player I ever heard that never stopped growing. You know, most jazz musicians, most players, they reach a certain point and they get famous for doing a certain thing and they get known for a certain thing, and then that's what they do for the rest of their life. They reiterate that thing because that's what they're famous for doing. Coltrane never stopped. You know, so he left a lot of people behind. It was very difficult for a lot of people to listen to him play, but that wasn't why he was playing,
right?
You know, that wasn't why he was playing, and that was the energy of the music that I got connected to first. You know, when I came to LA after Buddy's band, and I started doing all the pop things and all of the R&B things and all of the so-called commercial things that in commercial music, it was all very easy. You know, when you grow up listening to Coltrane and Ornette Coleman and Eric Dolphy and Joe Henderson and all these people, you know, that's all I listened to until I was maybe 21 years old. So I figured that was the way you played the saxophone.
Yeah.
So I learned how to play the saxophone like that. And then I found out, oh, I think I'm overtrained. I think I'm overtrained. But the thing is, it made everything else flow.
Right.
And the other thing is, it was still coming from aspects of that same kind of energy. You know, the blues, Marvin Gaye, all of those people, Bobby Blue Band, James Brown, all of that stuff, all of those blues things are coming from a deep concept of that spiritual, whatever you want to call it, that spiritual energy. They just took it to a certain point and they left it off. You know, it's like they took it to the entertainment level, but they didn't take it on. You know, they didn't take it to the next level. They didn't take it to the next level of music as prayer, you know, and that's what John did. And so that was always what that thing sort of always intrigued me, even before I knew anything about anything. When I first heard him play, it wasn't about the notes. The first thing I heard when I heard him play was this incredible sound. You know, there was something in that sound.
Right.
If he played a high C, if he played an A concert, whatever, wherever the note was that he played, there was an energy in that note that kind of grabbed you. And that's what got me when I was a kid. I didn't know it. I was a kid, you know, but there was something there that opened me up. And then when you start studying these guys and you start listening to these guys, they were incredible players.
Yeah.
You know, just incredible players. Nobody ever played anything on the saxophone like John Coltrane.
Right.
Nobody. Because he took it beyond the saxophone. It was beyond saxophone playing. It was some other stuff, you know. And there's not very many people that do that, you know. Michael did it a bit, but Michael really codified John. Yeah. He codified a lot of John's vocabulary, you know. So for me, when I listen, I always go back to John Coltrane. I mean, when I was a kid, when I was 13, I was listening to Impressions, Live at the Village Vanguard, 1961, 14 minutes of Impressions. And it was like,
yeah.
And I listened to it two or three nights ago. And it's still that.
Right.
Yeah.
Nobody did that. You know, this other thing he did during that same stay at the Village Vanguard in 1961, he did a thing called Chasing the Train. It's an F blues. It's nothing but an F blues. And they say, you know, what the authorities say is that was the first avant-garde saxophone solo that they class as that. You know, it's like everything else. There's never one person that just does something. You know, right. one person gets the credit for it, and there's about six or seven other guys that are doing the same thing at the same time. Right. You know, it was the same with the automobile. It was the same with the radio. It's the same with all of that. Anytime somebody does something that is a breakthrough thing, there's three or four other guys that are doing similar things. But John got the credit.
Right. For that.
Ford got the credit for the car. You know. But there's all of that, you know.
Do you have a particular favorite Coltrane album that you just keep coming back to? I mean, Kind of Blue for sure being Miles' record, but is there one of John's that you just love so much?
What is that?
I think it's a piano.
That's with me, yeah.
Sounds like a party at your place, man. We're coming over.
Yeah, right.
No, because there's so many.
There's too many good ones.
There was the Prestige years where he played all of those standards and every tune ever written.
I know, right?
All those Prestige things that were incredible. then there was all the Atlantic stuff, and that was all the Giant Steps stuff,
right.
and reharmonizations, you know, But Not For Me and Body and Soul, where he used those sequences
That's
in
right.
different parts of the tune. And then there was the Impulse stuff, and I would say, you know, he had it all put together by Love Supreme,
right?
And then that was his representation. That was his culmination of that vocabulary. Mm-hmm. Then he went on from there, you know.
Right.
I think one of his most incredible albums is Interstellar Space. It's just a duet album. It's a duo with Rashid Ali, but it's absolutely incredible saxophone playing. You know, as a saxophone player, as a player of that instrument, you listen to it in a different way than other people that just listen to the music. You know, when I listen to him playing that music, I know what he's doing to play that music, and it's ridiculous. You know, it's absolutely ridiculous.
Right.
Humanly ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like beyond the saxophone. So those kind of things I love to listen to. They're not easy listening.
Right.
I always go back to the stuff I grew up with. You know, I always go back to Impressions. I always go back to Chasing the Train, just like with Cannonball, where I always go back to the stuff from 1963 when he had that sextet with Yusef Lateef.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
That was one of the best bands I ever heard. Mm-hmm. I always go back to Art Blakey and his band that he had in 1963 with Freddie Hubbard and Wayne Shorter, you know?
So good.
And it was an incredible band.
Yeah.
And I heard them, you know, I went to, when I was in school, we would go into New York and go to Birdland because they had this section in Birdland called the Peanut Gallery. And you could go and you could listen, and there was no alcohol. This was the funniest thing, because I would go and I would listen to Art Blakey's band, and then they were trading sets with Jerry Mulligan's band, with Phil Woods and Jerry Dogen and all of those guys. And Jerry Mulligan's band would come on, and they'd sound like an organ. You know, it was just this totally controlled kind of sound. And then Art Blakey's band would come on and they'd sound like a big band.
Yeah.
You know, Art Blakey, these guys, they sound like a big band. And then Jerry Mulligan's band would come on and they'd sound like a small control thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that flipped me out, you know. Cedar Walton, you know, Jimmy Merritt, all of those guys, you know, Curtis Fuller.
Yeah.
Wayne Shorter and Freddie Hubbard. Freddie Hubbard was incredible during that time.
Sure was.
You know, he was an unbelievable trumpet player. And I got to hear all of those people. And yeah. I got to hear all the bands, you know, when I was in high school. I had a neighbor. We grew up in a row house in Wilmington, Delaware. And a row house is really what you would call a townhouse now. So our walls were connected. So I had a neighbor that heard me playing. He heard me practicing, and he started taking me. His name was Alden Jenkins. He started taking me to concerts and things. He gave me the first jazz record I ever heard that wasn't mine was an Art Blakey record called Jazz Goes to College.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and I heard Paul Desmond, you know. And I heard Paul Desmond, and I could play the stuff on my record player, and I could play with Paul Desmond. So I figured, oh, this jazz thing is not too hard because I can play with this guy on the record. Man, he's famous and I can play with this guy on the record. And then after that, you know, he would lend me Charlie Parker and Eric Dolphy and all these things. And I'm going, oh, there's something else there. To say that during this time in America, this was the early 60s, there were places where all of the big bands, Count Basie's band, Duke Ellington's band, Maynard Ferguson's band, Stan Kenton's band, Tommy Dorsey, all of these bands were still working, right? And there were these amusement parks all over the East Coast, Hershey, Pennsylvania, on the Jersey Shore, all of these places where there were these amusement parks that had these big dance halls. And all of these bands would play at these dance halls for dances. And then all of the kids, all the music kids would stand up in the front of the bandstand and listen to the musicians and check out what the musicians are doing. So when I was a young kid, I went and I heard all of those bands because of my neighbor. And that was a beautiful thing.
Wow.
You know.
Yeah,
then,
right.
Yeah, and then something happened. I had this was like a miracle thing that happened for me that was kind of weird because it was so long ago. I after a while, I didn't believe it was real. I thought it was a dream.
Mm-hmm.
I went to hear Count Basie with a friend of mine, and we were standing up in the front, and they were getting to the end of the gig, and Marshall Royal didn't feel good. He was the legendary lead alto player with Count Basie.
Yeah.
It was Marshall Royal and Frank Foster was in that band, and he wrote all those charts. Thad Jones was in that band. That was a great band, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So Marshall Royal wasn't feeling bad, and he went in the back, and the band took a break. And me, 17 years old, or whatever I was, I go up to Frank Foster, right? I go up to Frank Foster, and I say, hey, can I sit in? and then they look at me. Frank West was playing second alto, so he switched over to play lead. They looked at me and they said, yeah. So I got up there. They gave me Marshall's horn, right? Because I didn't have my horn. They gave me Marshall's horn, and I played the last set of the gig second alto in that band. With Frank West playing lead, you know, and Frank Foster and all of these guys. And then at the end of the gig, you know, Marshall comes out at the end of the gig, you know, and he's bugged because I got his horn. So he comes out at the end of the gig and he says, give me a horn, you know. So I gave him the horn and he split. But that happened, and it happened so long ago, and nobody ever talked about it, that I thought maybe it was like something, it was a dream, it was an illusion. I was playing somewhere one time, and some guy comes up to me and he says, hey, Ernie, do you remember when you were in high school and you played with Count Basie's band? And I'm like, oh, yeah. I did. So that was an amazing thing. So, you know,
truly
life is like that, right? A thousand miracles, a thousand little miracles.
Beautiful story. Wow, that's so cool. What a great story.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know anything. You know, my neighbor took me to the University of Delaware used to have concerts, right? Now the University of Delaware had Cannonball one time. So I go backstage, Cannon is there, Nat's there, Yusef is there, Louis Hayes, Sam Jones, and Joe Zawinul, right? Mm-hmm. That band.
The band, right? Yeah.
And my favorite band, my favorite Cannonball band. So I go up and I talk to Cannon And he's just the friendliest guy you ever would want to meet, just a sweetheart. And I said, "Hey, Cannon, can I try your horn?" And he said, "Well, you know what? You know what, Ernie? I'm going to go out and do this gig. I'm worried about my reed. I don't want to mess up my reed, you know. So let me go out and do this gig. And when I come back after the gig, you can try my alto." And I said, "Yeah, well, cool." You know, and I went back after the gig and he let me play his horn.
Yeah.
I don't even know if he remembers that, because we got pretty tight in L.A. I started working with Cannon's band with Roy McCurdy and everybody at one
time. Yeah.
You know, through David Axelrod. I was doing dates with David, and David was producing Cannon for Capitol.
Right.
So we did some dates with Cannon, and we spent a lot of time together. And I don't know if he remembered that. But we did 3 or 4 recordings. I did the Black Saint. No, that's I did the
Black Messiah.
Black Messiah, yeah. Black mm-hmm. Saint and Sinner later is Charlie.
Right. That's Mingus.
Charlie Mingus, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. Mm. That's another thing. Charlie Mariano was on that.
Mm-hmm.
Mariano was on the Black Saint and the Sinner Lady, and it's some of the most beautiful alto playing I've ever heard. Mm.
Yeah.
And Charlie was my improv teacher when I was at Berkeley.
Uh-huh.
I stayed with Charlie then, and Charlie was going in to New York to do those dates when I was going to school there.
Studying. Right.
So there's all of these correlations, you know.
Love it.
Yeah. Yeah. And actually, now you mentioned about improv, because obviously I've listened a bunch to your playing and, you know, like your way of improvising. And is there any way, like, how you can explain a little bit how you go about improvisation, but not, you know, not the technique side, scales and chords and all of that, but something. Like, for example, I've heard Wayne Shorter play or say something that when he starts playing, he starts from zero. He doesn't think about anything. And, you know, when we just heard your version of Inner Urge, you know, like you, it's like a conversation or a story that you're trying to tell. So what are your thoughts about that? Like when you're actually improvising?
Well, The goal and what we aspire to is to be able to spontaneously play anything that we hear spontaneously. So that's our life's journey, you know, to learn. That's why we practice, to play so much, to play so well, that you transcend your instrument. There are no notes, there are no keys, and you play what you hear. The more you play, the more you practice, the more spiritual everything gets too, the more spiritual music gets too. And at a certain point, the spirit plays through you. And when the spirit is moving through you as music, then you're in the audience too. You know, you're a tool of this energy that goes through you. You know, I tell people, music is God singing through us. Music is the way that the Holy Spirit comes to earth to bring beauty, to bring love, to bring joy. The energy comes through us. That's how the Holy Spirit sings, you know. So getting to that is the work. You know, you have to play to the point where you don't even think about it. And that's what Wayne is talking about. You know, that's what you start from nowhere. You think of nothing. You let the Holy Spirit play the music through you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what it can get to.
Mm-hmm.
but you have to get there. You know, I have a little joke I tell Patricia, well, you know, you can't get there if you don't go.
That's right.
You can't get there if you don't go. So it's a long trip that way. So I would tell people that are improvising to play, you know, to become music. Mm. You know, the musician doesn't play music, we become music.
Mm.
We are music, because music is what we come from. Music is our, is what we value, and so therefore it's a part of our consciousness, so therefore it is us. So when we play, we become music.
Mm.
So then when you make that recognition and you understand that you're a tool of this energy, or whatever you want to call it, whatever your philosophy is, you know, about this thing that is ineffable, that nobody can put words to. So whatever your philosophy is about this thing, the end result is to become this thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way you can get there is to really put yourself into it. And that's mm-hmm. a lifetime, you know. Mm-hmm. And we start, your life has chapters. We start from the beginning. What do you want to do first? This is America. Everything's a football game. So if you're a player, you want to be the best you can be. Mm-hmm. You want to play higher, you want to play faster, if you're a horn player or whatever, you want to play first seat, you want to be the best, you want to be first call, blah, blah, blah. Then after a while, it's like you get to, well, okay, but why? Mm-hmm. What is it for? You know, what is this? What is it? You know, and then when you ask yourself that question, then it opens the other door.
Right.
There's a lot of ways to improvise. There's a lot of ways to play, because there's a lot of people. And we're all part of infinite energy. And so we all are unique individual beings, mm-hmm. you know? And so some of us are, we all have our personal reasons for doing this. And they're all valid, you know? There's, at a certain point, there's no rules. It's just your personal perception. It's all perception. So I think that people who want to improvise, I know that most of us, what we did was we found people that we really love to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
You listen to them until that stuff starts coming out of you.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that stuff starts coming out of you, then you say, okay, I understand John Coltrane. I understand Charlie Parker. I understand Joe Henderson. I understand Eric Dolphy. Now, how do I feel about this stuff?
Mm-hmm.
You know, who am I in here? Because if you knew John Coltrane, or if you knew Charlie Parker, or if you knew Joe Henderson, or any of these other people, they would tell you, what do you think?
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't play like me, play like you. You know, in fact, Monk said that, you know, there's some funny quotes from Monk about, you know, don't play like me, play like you. Mm-hmm. I'm accompanying you. You're not supposed to be accompanying me.
Mm-hmm. You know?
So there's all that stuff. It's life. Yeah. Yeah, it's life. Music is life. Jazz is, you know, jazz is music. Jazz is life. It's all a part of this. It's all a part of this endless energy. You know, this infinite energy, and how much you relate to it and how much you recognize it, because the use of it and the work with it is related to your recognition of it, right? It's done unto you as you believe. What you believe, you create.
Mm-hmm.
And if you think you can, you can. If you think you can't, you can't. And that's the only divider. It's perception, right? And if you have something in your head, like when I was a kid and I didn't know anything and all I knew was I wanted to be a musician, all these doors opened up and I was put around all of these incredible musicians. Mm-hmm. I don't even know how I got there, except I really love music and I really love to play. So I was this idiot kid that practiced all the time. Mm-hmm. You know? And these people recognized something that reminded them of themselves, probably. Mm-hmm. You say, oh yeah, I was a stupid, arrogant kid like that too when I was 16. That's really cool.
Yeah.
There's all of that.
Yeah, that, well, wow, that's some wisdom right there.
Sure is.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's life.
Yeah, that's true. Well, why don't we go to another bit of music? Because I would like to take it back to your time in Buddy Rich's band. Because you're actually on, in my opinion, one of the most successful and one of the most famous records that Buddy actually ever made, which was Big Swing Face, which is a live record, live from Shea Club in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And I would actually want to play the title track, Big Swing Face, off of this, because that's actually you playing alto on this recording. And so let's listen to this, and afterwards we'll have a little talk about this. For everybody who just chimed in, we're here with special guest Ernie Watts, saxophone player, and we're going to listen to Big Swing Face of the Buddy Rich Big Band with Ernie on alto.
I hope it's okay.
Yeah, buddy.
Great solo. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I was like 20.
Uh-huh.
20 then. Yeah. That was that club was on Santa Monica Boulevard.
Uh-huh.
We played there quite often. In fact, I think that's when I met Johnny Carson first. They used to come. Everybody loved Buddy. So if they were in town, they would come to see him. So I met Johnny Carson and you know, Ed McMahon was there. All of those people were there. Mm-hmm. Judy Garland was there.
Wow.
Yeah, all that time ago. So it was great.
Yeah.
We did another album with Buddy that a lot of people don't know about. We did an album with A La Rocca, the tabla player that played with Ravi Shankar all those years.
Okay. I don't know that.
They did an album, and I don't know what happened with that.
Huh.
Yeah. Hmm. A lot of things just disappear.
Mm.
Yeah.
I did a whole bunch of recording with Frank Zappa and George Duke and John Guerin, and they were all jazz things, and I don't know what happened to them. It was during the same time that we did King Kong, which was Jean-Luc Ponty's first CD when he came to the United States. Mm. And that was all Frank's tunes.
Mm.
You know, so it's amazing where things go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because there's a lot of stuff that you do and you don't know what happens to it. Mm-hmm. Or you do it and they call it one thing, and then when it comes out, it's called something else.
Right.
Title. So it's, you know, you never know. That's why you have to play your best every time. Right. You never know where it's going to end up.
You never know. Right. Oh, wow.
Right.
True.
There's nowhere to go to sound bad except at home.
Yeah.
and then your neighbors are listening to you.
Yeah. I was actually curious if you can talk a little bit about your overall experience with Buddy and the band, because, you know, you were very young and all of that, and, you know, generally it's pretty known, you know, like what kind of band leader a Buddy could be from time to time. But what the biggest takeaway was for you when you played with him in his band.
Well, I think that it was the tightest band I ever played with.
Mm.
Because when I hear those YouTubes now, I forgot about how tight that band was.
Mm.
But part of that was the sound that he got. He tuned his drums high.
Mm.
And so everything was crackly. Everything popped.
Mm-hmm. You know?
And it was a special kind of sound that he got on the drums. Also, he had his episodes. You know, everybody talks about his episodes. They don't talk about how great a player he was as much as they talk about his episodes.
Right, indeed.
He became one of those people. You know how Keith Jarrett got because he didn't like people when they coughed, and he didn't like it when they talked, and he would get bugged, and then he would tell them, you know, he would give them a little lecture.
Uh-huh.
And then they would set him up. You know, there were people that would come to heckle Keith.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, there were people that would come to heckle Buddy. They'd like to set him off because he grew up in vaudeville. So he knew all of the stuff. He knew all the one-liners. He knew all the jokes. I mean, this guy did. He was Traps the Boy Wonder.
Mm-hmm.
Baby Traps
the drum wonder when he was like a year and a half old. 18 months old, and he created his mom and dad's career.
Yeah.
Now there's now here's a story, and I don't know if this is true. I'm going to tell you, I don't know if this is true, but it could be.
Mm-hmm.
I did the Tonight Show for 20 years, and the contractor on this show was a guy named Al Lappin. And he was in radio. He was in vaudeville. He was an older man. He told a story about when he was a percussionist. He was a pit percussionist. And there's a story in the book that Mel Torme wrote about Buddy, where he was sitting on the edge of the bandstand where the pit band was playing when his mom and dad were rehearsing, were getting ready. And he was playing on his with his hands on his knees with the drummer when he was about a year and a half old, and he made all the hits. Mm-hmm. All the hits, everything. That's when they realized that he had this gift, you know. That's when he became a part of the show. Now, going back to this guy, Al Lappin, he says that he was the drummer that was in the pit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but he did that. And he remembered that. So that's an interesting thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was a he lived to about 94. Al Lappin did. He was the contractor on the Tonight Show band the whole time it was there. He was the contractor at NBC the whole time they had staff orchestras. Mm. And he had these malapropisms he used to do that were incredible. He would say, you know, if it's not one thing, it's right after the other. Enough to give aspirin a headache. You know, he would come up with all of this incredible stuff. So anyway, that's a little side story. I don't know if it's true, but it certainly could be. But that's where Buddy came from. He didn't, he learned to read when he was 7 or 8 years old, you know, because he was on the road all the time with his family.
Right.
His aunt and uncle took him for a year or so that he could study, so he could go to school in Muskegon, Michigan. And that's where he learned how to read and stuff. Otherwise, he was in music his whole life. He did not read.
Yeah.
So when we had a rehearsal, we would rehearse in the club and we'd play the music without him, and we'd play it twice, and he'd go up and sit at the drums and he'd make all the hits. Mm-hmm. You know, he knew the chart. So he was an amazing, brilliant man. And he had a short temper. Mm-hmm. You know, he did have a short temper. And I watched it, you know, and I saw him go off many, many times. Number one, he never went off for nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, there was always some reason. There was always something that would happen, you know. And then he would go off and make his point and say something angry. And then rather than make his point and stop, he couldn't stop. It was like he got an endorphin rush off of the finger. He got an energy shot from anger.
Right.
So I saw that happen quite a few times. I mean, we would go to a gig and we would play at a club and he wouldn't be feeling well, right? So he would play. And he might actually be a little lackluster or miss something, you know. So at the end of the set, he'd fire all of us. He'd fire the band. He'd fire the whole band. And he says, now, you guys are fired. And this is it unless you get it together.
Right.
Right. And then he would get a charge from that. And then we go back on the stand and we play the same way we played the first set. But he played great, right? Because he was bugged, right? And so he came back and said, yeah, that's better. Or before we went on stage, you know, we played at Royal Albert Hall in London and all of these incredible places. And before we go on the stand, he'd say, swing or I'll kill you. swing or I'll kill you. And, you know, and he was half joking and he was half true, but he was the best drummer.
Yeah.
That he was the best drummer. And people don't realize that he played on the Charlie Parker with strings recording, and he just played yep. brushes.
Mm.
He would just do that, you know. He could do any of that stuff.
Yeah.
But he was an incredible drummer.
Mm.
Yeah.
So, right on.
Yeah, and so I respect that.
Yeah.
You know, when somebody is that gifted, you can be forgiving.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the way I feel.
Yeah.
True words.
If somebody's got something like that, you can be forgiving.
Right.
You know.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, that is really great. Thank you.
That's how LA though.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
He hated ballads. This guy named Don Peisserf, he wrote this beautiful chart on What's It All About, Alfie.
Uh-huh.
Right? It got faster every night. His buddy hated ballads.
Uh-huh.
And so one night I said, it was an alto feature, you know, it was a ballad, so it was an alto feature. So it was a foxtrot by then, you know, it started out as a ballad. It was a foxtrot by then. You know, so I turned around, I said to Buddy, I said, Buddy, if we're going to play it this fast, we should do another tune. And he said, 2 weeks. You got 2 weeks. And so that's how I got to LA. He fired me on the road and I went to LA.
Wow. That's like, great.
And then like 3 weeks later, he called me to come back because they were going to Vegas and they did Mercy, Mercy, Mercy.
Uh-huh.
And I was already, by then, I was starting to do dates and stuff. So he got Art Pepper. And that's how Art Pepper joined Buddy's band.
Right on.
Yeah. So it's a funny thing, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it's all weaved together.
it's a funny life.
Yeah.
And he used to come, and he used to come on the Tonight Show all the time.
That's right.
Very, very kind. And we had a great time.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing.
Yeah.
Why don't we move on to some more music, Josh?
Okay. Ernie, I was going to place the title track from the Oasis record for something different, but I wonder if you maybe would rather hear something from Homelight, because that's your more recent quartet record. Do you have a preference?
Yeah, there's something from Homelight that I'd love to play.
Oh yeah?
Different. Yeah, it's like a tribute to Ornette's music.
Mm,
great.
I always wanted to do something for Ornette. It's the fourth track. It's called Freaky Flyers.
Yep, we have that. Great. Yeah,
and it's a and it's something that's a little different.
Great. So this is also on your label, Flying Dolphin.
Yeah, record. This is on Flying Dolphin. This is called Homelight.
There it is. Yeah, beautiful.
That's the most recent one.
We
did some gigs and COVID came.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
So it's still a new album.
Right. Yes. And this is with the European group, right? Sanger, yeah, and this is
with Christoph Sanger.
Yep.
Rudy Engel on bass and Heinrich Kerberling on drums.
Great. Well, we'll listen to Freaky Flyers. Is that how you say it?
Yeah, Freaky Flyers. That's Patricia Spelling. She created.
Oh.
She created those words.
Well, I like it.
Used to be frequent flyers.
Yeah.
And then one day Heinrich said, "You freaky flyers!" Then it became Freaky Flyers, and then I spelled flyers wrong when I was typing, and I liked that spelling, so that's right. How it got to be that.
And before you do it, I'm going to tell you another crazy story.
Sure.
Patricia and I take the trains all the time, all over the country. We get to Chicago, and we're at the place where our ride picks us up. Right, it's at this one corner in Chicago. All of a sudden, these three fire engines show up, hook and ladder. The sirens are going. The firemen jump off, and then they're looking, right? And one fireman yells at the other, Did you see him? Did you see him? And then the other guy says, no, he was a freaky flyer. And there were homeless, you know, there's homeless people that do stuff all the time and then they run away. And so something happened with this guy and they were trying to find him and they couldn't find him and they called him a freaky flyer. And this CD was already out. So anyway, this is Freaky Flyer.
nice setup. Good story. I love it. Okay, looking forward. Here we go. Thank you. That's fun. What a great, great tune. Great performances from the whole band. Wow.
It's another way. There's a lot of ways to look at it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
What do you mean actually with that? Like with the many ways that you can look at it?
To approach music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's always that thing. There's always that art thing, right? Especially with people like Ornette and different artists. It's like, where does the music stop and the noise begin? Or when does it stop being noise and become music?
Huh.
You know, and so it's always totally up to the listener.
Right.
You know, what was the old line that I don't agree with about Duke? He used to say there's two kinds of music, good music and bad music.
Mm.
But that's totally subjective.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, if you like it, it's good. If you don't like it, it's bad.
Right.
And that's, you know, there it is.
Yeah.
You know, if you like it, it's for you. If you don't like it, it's not for you. If you go somewhere and you hear something that you don't like, then go somewhere else and listen to something that you like. You know? It's like, you don't want to come and not like something and then spend all your time criticizing it.
Yeah, right. Right.
Unless you like criticizing.
Yeah.
Some people that get into that, you know. And they tell you all the ways that they don't like something.
Right.
And that makes them feel good. So, you know, it's like, it's the human critter, very complicated little animal.
Wow. And just, you know, your flexibility to me as an artist to fully immerse yourself in whatever you're doing, whether it's, you know, I guess good or bad, but hopefully good. But like, stylistically, you just own whatever you do. And I've always been so impressed with that, Ernie, you know, whether it's on an R&B record, whether it's something like we just heard, which is kind of on the more outside side of jazz, or if it's, you know, playing with Buddy Rich. It's just, I think that's a testament to your strength of a bit of your artistry, that you can kind of make it you. It always sounds like you, but you're also very flexible for the situation and the music, which I feel like a lot of young players sometimes are hesitant. They just want to do what they do. Kind of going back to what you said earlier, you know, right, about like, well, this is my thing. But I love that your career has all these different twists and turns. It just keeps it interesting, and you're just an incredible artist.
Well, you know that the music tells you what to play.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I used to tell people, you don't go to a Marvin Gaye gig and play a John Coltrane solo.
Right.
He would have dug it.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
You know, he loved all kinds of music. He would have dug it, but it wouldn't have got on the record.
Right. Yeah, exactly. What's appropriate for the music?
The music tells you. The music tells you what to play.
Right.
It's like I did hundreds of I did hundreds of solo overdubs where everything was all done and they needed an 8-bar saxophone solo and a fade. And I would listen to the track and I would listen to the artist. And by the time I was ready to play, I pretty much knew what I was going to play because it was a part of the tune.
Right.
You know? So.
Yeah.
The music will tell you what to play.
Mm. Well said.
Yeah.
Thanks for that.
With all of that.
Thank you.
Right on.
Do you have something else you want to... Before we release Mr. Watts to the
evening. Yeah. I wanted to play something as our last tune, basically, from your time with Charlie Hayden, with the Quartet West, with you, Alan Broadband. And then it started, I think, with Billy Higgins, and then Lawrence Marble took right. over. And this is from the record in Angel City, it's called. And I wanted to play a tune that's maybe, you know, I don't know where you would put it on the spectrum, but I thought that it would be cool to show a little bit of music in straight eights. And this tune is called The Red Wind.
Oh, that's Pat's tune.
It's Pat's, Pat Metheny.
Yeah.
Well, let's listen to it and then we'll have a little talk about it. The Red Wind.
Thank you.
gorgeous.
I gotta find that tune. Yeah, I forgot that tune. I need to be playing that tune.
It's a god, he writes great tunes. Matheny tunes always just get me. They're so good.
Yeah. There's a lot in them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can you give a little bit of an insight about how this band worked? One of the things that stands out to me, and particularly also this album, is that, and one of the qualities of the band is that you guys were at times very much sounding like a hard hitting hard bop band, but then when you guys would play ballads, it's the complete opposite of the spectrum, that you guys play very introvert and more humble and all of that. So I was kind of wondering about the creative stuff that went behind that band and how it basically worked.
Well, it's like we were talking about before. The music plays itself.
Mm.
So when Charlie brought a tune, and we heard the tune, and we felt the tune, we knew what to play.
Mm.
We never had a rehearsal. You know, we never had let's come over to the studio and rehearse for 3 hours on Thursday.
Uh-huh.
Everything we ever did was at a sound check. If there was any kind of a rehearsal, we had a long sound check. We often had long sound checks because Charlie was very extremely particular about sound.
Mm.
And we needed carpeting. There was a time that he had tinnitus badly, and we used to have to use plexiglass, you know, and we were dependent upon for Charlie, you know, he'd be in a plexiglass box, and then we'd be playing, and he'd be at the back of the stage in a plexiglass box, and we'd be playing. So I started calling the band Alone Together. He eventually got over the tinnitus thing and got closer with the band. But he was very, very aware of sound, very, very sensitive about sound and balance and that kind of thing. So we had some very interesting sound checks.
Mm.
But we learned a lot of music. And that's what we would do. We would play something at a sound check, and we would say, yeah.
Mm.
Then we would play it that night. And I think that's what happened with most of these pieces. So it wasn't that, you know, we didn't really talk about music. You know, there's things about, there's people that talk about Miles and say that, you know, and then there's things that you hear where, to me, and I think I got this from reading something about Miles, is like, when you put a band together, when you play with people, you play with people that you don't have to tell what to play,
mm-hmm.
you know, because you already know that they can do it. And that's why they're there.
Mm-hmm.
So there's never rehearsals with, you know, do this or do this that way or sound like this or whatever. It's like you're there because you are doing what you're doing. Then the only things you talk about is, okay, where's the coda? You know, how are we going to end it? Is it a fade or is it a long ending? And some of that stuff you don't even talk about, that you just play it, and we would talk about things and play it, and it was supposed to have a long ending, and I mean a long note at the ending, and Charlie would be feeling good and we'd go into a vamp and play for another 8 minutes.
Mm.
You know, and all of those things happened. It was what you would say, it was very organic,
right?
We did a lot of string music. Alan wrote a lot of string music. He's a beautiful arranger,
mm-hmm.
string arranger. And we played a lot of orchestral concerts. Now, there was more form with those, you know, we did things with Bill Henderson and Shirley Horn, and
mm-hmm.
we had to have form so that the string players didn't flip out.
Right.
You know, so here's where it starts, you know. Here's where the solo is. Goes out, okay. Try not to slow down.
Yeah.
And so there was more control with that. But when we played with the quartet, we just played.
Yep.
You know, and mm. that was the theory. But I think it's because we already knew who we were before we got there.
Mm.
Yeah, you know.
Well said.
Yeah.
No, he was like that.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, we could go on and on about your career because you've done so much, and we just, you know, like barely touched, you know, like the tip of the iceberg. But I think it's a good time to wrap it up because we've been at it for almost 2 hours. So, Ernie, I would like to thank you on behalf of Josh and myself for, you know, like talking in depth about your vision and about your music and the way how you feel about music. It's been super, super, super inspiring to hear you talk about that and how, what kind of influence Coltrane had on you. So thank you very much for giving us such an insight, such a meaningful insight with so much wisdom.
Well, thank you, Kevin. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you one more funny story, and it's very, very short.
Sure.
Phil Woods was quite a character.
Uh-huh.
And he did an interview. He did a long interview. And then the interviewer asks him, at the end of the interviewer says, "Phil, where do you think jazz is going?"
Uh-huh.
Phil looked at him and said, "Well, you know, right now, jazz is going to have dinner."
I think that goes for all of us right now.
Jazz is going to have dinner now.
That's right.
All right.
Thank you so much, Ernie.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, yeah. Patricia.
Yeah, thank you, Patricia. for everybody at home, thank you guys for joining us. In 2 weeks, we will be back with a special tribute show with Scott Whitfield and Sal Lozano, with a tribute to the great Sammy Nestico, who recently passed. Our thanks again to Ernie Watts, and we'll see everybody hopefully in 2 weeks again. So thank you, Ernie.
Thank you, Ernie. Okay. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye.